Greetings, everybody, and welcome back to Killer Frequency. It's me, the Mick, and last time we left off, we now have to go into fucking Captain Murder Hobo's stabby dungeon. And figure out what the fuckery is up. Oh, this is the wrong place to go. So I really don't want to do this, but fucking, I don't think I have a choice. We found a different record. And we found the record outside, so I'm going to keep an eye out for other records. Can I still... Oh, I can. I'm going to just put that shut. Where was his office? That was the break room.
Not getting in there tonight.
Where was it? I don't remember how to get in there, to be honest with you. Hold on.
Locked. For now.
For now. Oh, here we go. No? Shit. So this is the break room. Where the fuck was the... Do I have to go back out here? Why is this also just still wide the fuck open? I feel like that's a problem. Alright, time to go back into the murder room. Okay, so what am I looking for exactly?
The key. Was this always here? I must have missed it when I brought everything upstairs.
Found basement storage key. I don't want to, though. I really don't want to. And these keep shutting, so it makes me think that there's gonna be a fucking jump scar. Anything in there? No? Okay. Okay. So is this basement storage? This definitely looks like a place.
Hey, Warren.
Peggy, give me some warning before yelling down the intercom.
Sorry. Buzz the intercom when you find something and want to discuss it.
Okay. Sure, Peggy.
Peggy, I've found a tape and a map down here.
A map of what?
Looks like it might be to somewhere in this storage area.
Weird. Well, maybe the tape will give us more information. Give it a play.
Where's the eject button? Okay.
George Bell, 1968. That's when this all began for me.
Okay.
Follow the maps. Find the tapes. I'll be waiting.
Wait. George Barrow? We all heard that he drowned after a night out drinking. Was it actually Clive? Has Clive really been the whistling man for that long?
He says I need to follow the maps and find the tapes. I guess that's what this map is about.
We need to see what else is hidden down here.
I don't think we do.
Be careful for us. Keep looking. Buzz the intercom when you found something.
Okay. I think this is a terrible idea.
Time of autopsy is 7 a.m. Cause of death is asphyxiation from drowning.
Yeah, that's great.
The degree of rigor mortis indicates that the subject has been deceased for 5 hours. That puts the time of death.
We got more. So let's pick this one up. I don't like this. This sucks. This sucks massive donkey dick. Okay, nothing in there. What am I looking for here? Okay, it's a shite photo. Hold on, let me get into the light. Okay, it looks like a carpet, some chairs. Bitch? And some soundproofing. Excuse the fuck out of me, bitch? I don't like this. Oh, here it is.
Small lacerations to arms, legs, and face. Typically obtained by running through foliage.
Okay.
Blistering to the feet. As though the deceased had been running without stopping.
Okay. Right, fuck is this place? No, that's not fuck. Okay, I'm assuming that's deeper in this way. Bitch, oh. I'm out here like fighting for my life and nothing's even happening yet. Is it back here? I feel like that one's not it. So, oh, here we go. Yeah, okay, so this is it.
Preliminary toxicology results shows no signs of inebriation. However, a high amount of cortisol was found, indicating elevated levels of stress in the immediate moments before death.
Yeah, probably. Why? Like, what the fuck is with all this, like, red tape shit? I don't fucking get it.
Additionally, there appears to be a post-mortem injury to the arm. It looks like it was trapped in a car door.
A car door? Is there another thing? Hold up, where's the other picture? Is there not another picture? What the fuck? Why is there not another picture? Oh, here it is. Okay. Oh, some of these have like journals next to them. So hold on.
This looks useful.
Sheriff Matthews. At 4 a.m., a call was received from a jogger, a Miss Sandra Sharp, reporting that a body had been found washed up in the reservoir. I drove out to investigate and was able to identify the body at the scene as that of George Barrow. I contacted the coroner's office and then the boy's parents. They informed me that they had not seen him since 7 p.m. on the 2nd. Okay, so we're going to keep that. Okay. So this is showing other shit. Okay. Okay, so this is okay. So this. All right, let's pick this up.
This has to be important.
The deceased is a Caucasian male, age 18. The cause of death is established to be drowning, as shown by the signs of asphyxiation. Abrasions were found on the knuckles, likely from getting into fights in the past. Matches with known history of the deceased being aggressive. No other injuries were observed, and from the coroner's opinion, there is no evidence of foul play. Additionally, preliminary toxicology indicates the deceased had a high level of alcohol in their blood. It is the coroner's opinion that the deceased went swimming while intoxicated, resulting in his drowning. Whoa! No, that's not what was said, though. That's not what they said, though. That's not what this chick said.
It is the coroner's opinion that the subject likely feared for his life and was chased, resulting in a fall from a height into a body of water, where he hit his head, was knocked out, and drowned. Following that, he was moved.
Dr. Sullivan, we need to have a talk. That recording. Shut it off.
Okay. So now I gotta go find a... So, okay, this is the desk.
If you're listening to this,
What the?
I'm a man who likes to stay informed. I've got subscriptions to newspapers all over the country. A few weeks ago, I noticed headlines cropping up in those papers, one after the other. Each headline about a murder.
Okay.
Each murder, the death of someone I knew almost 20 years ago.
Okay.
And each one drawing closer to Gallows Creek. Drawing closer to the anniversary. None of us are innocent. But I don't think we deserve a killing. All I hope now is that I can save some folk from the worst. And I can.
Ooh, a new vinyl for my collection.
Do something to make up for what I did back then, I guess. I didn't kill anyone, mind you. But that's past mattering. Now, there's more I could say than I should say. But my employer made it clear that my family would pay a high price if I ever spoke out. So, hopefully I've said enough for you, listener, whoever the hell you are, to start putting the truth together.
Okay, so the Whistling Man never died. That's what I'm getting at from here. What's this? Can I fucks with this? No? Okay. So that's what I'm getting, is the Whistling Man never died, and that they fucked up the autopsy, and it was a victim of the Whistling Man that died. Okay. Okay, this doesn't make any sense.
What have you found, Forrest?
It's an autopsy tape. Doesn't say for who, but
yeah,
I think it must be for George.
Poor George. He was so young.
Something's bugging me, Peggy.
What do you mean?
I swear I recognize the voice of the woman talking on the tape. I just can't place it.
Seriously? Do you think you've met her before?
I don't know. I mean, I just got here recently. I don't know. Found another tape. It talks more about how George died.
What did it say?
It sounds like he was running for his life. Sprinting through trees and bushes, getting cut up all over.
What would drive someone to do that?
I'm not sure yet. There's also a tape about a toxicology report. There were no signs of drinking or that he was on anything.
What? But everyone said he went swimming drunk and drowned.
Yeah.
It was in the newspaper and everything.
I found a written autopsy report.
What does it say?
According to that, it's just like you said at the start. George drowned after getting drunk. Said he liked to fight, too.
But that contradicts the tape.
I know. And I think I know why. There's a note with the report that says, "I'm sorry I made you do this, Virginia."
If it was on the autopsy report, then Virginia must be our coroner. Wait, the caller from earlier. When we had to call the takeout restaurants, wasn't her name Virginia?
Oh.
We need to call her back once we finish down here. It looks like she might know something about what's going on. I found a tape that introduces a new detail to the story. Post-mortem injury. Apparently, his arm got caught in a car door.
A car door?
Yeah, after he died. How do you suppose they can tell?
How can they tell? I'm a radio producer,
yeah.
Not a coroner.
So, oh, that was post-mortem.
The written report I found doesn't mention it at all.
How did his arm get trapped in a car door after he died?
Unless he got it when the police collected his body?
I guess
someone else must have moved it after he was dead to where he was eventually found.
But the report, what is going on here?
I found a police report.
Mentions
a friend from earlier.
Thickens.
Sandra Sharp.
The jazz runner?
Oh, yeah, the one
that's
dead.
She found George's body washed up at the reservoir.
The reservoir?
Yeah? What's strange about that?
George got cuts from running through foliage, right? But there's no forest around there. Also, how did it wash up at the reservoir?
What do you mean?
Reservoirs don't have tides.
But that's what the police report said.
It not possible, though. I did a school project on reservoirs and got an A.
Oh, well, but, then you're an expert.
Yeah, not important right now. The important
got
thing
it.
Is that it doesn't make sense.
What so the body was moved.
That the body was originally found somewhere other than what the report suggests. That the sheriff tried to cover it up, but accidentally let something slip?
Something like that, I think.
Well, Sheriff Matthews wrote the report. If he hadn't been eviscerated, we could have asked him.
And Sandra
so they all falsified.
In another tape, the coroner comes to the same conclusion as I did. George was running from something.
Maybe yeah. an animal?
Maybe, but then there's this next bit, where the coroner thinks he was moved post-death.
So she agrees with us.
At the end of the yeah. tape, someone burst in and demanded Virginia stop recording. I think it was Clive.
This is starting to make sense now. This is a conspiracy to cover up what happened to George.
I think I found Clive's last recording. I think Clive might be gone.
Gone?
I found a confession. Not for any killings, but for playing a part in covering up George's death. He left this behind in case he died. He hoped someone would find it.
This is not making any sense to me.
Do you think the whistling man already got him?
Possibly. We've had a lot of callers tonight, but maybe not every victim made it to the phone, you know? We
Could
don't
be.
Know how many there really are.
Christ, Forrest, that's dark.
I know.
And it's true, though.
Clive said he had read about other murders in other towns, and that the murders were all folks who knew about the incident. And the killings were getting closer to Gallows Creek. He said he wanted to do something good for once.
The board in his office. He wasn't tracking people down to kill them. He was tracking them down to save them. Ugh, why
sure.
didn't he just come out with all of this?
He said his employer threatened his family if he spoke out about any of it.
His employer? The one who orchestrated the cover-up? Oh, Clive. I'm sorry for thinking you'd killed all those people. Do you think you found everything?
I think so.
Forrest, what's going on here?
Someone wanted that boy's death to seem like an accident. And they hired Clive to make it look that way.
Come back upstairs when you're ready. We need to figure out our next step.
So, I have a theory. Whoever he was working for, and it could be
Thank
the God police
station.
Thank
God you're back, Forrest. I've been running out of stuff to pad our airtime with.
Peggy, you work in radio.
Forrest, I'm stressed. I mean, really?
Put these here.
How are we supposed to keep a show going with all this happening?
It's our job.
This is our job, Peggy. We gotta do it.
You're right. So, what's the plan now?
I think we should call Virginia back.
All right, I'll get her on the line.
Okay.
Okay, Forrest, shut the music off.
God, why can't I throw this? Man!
Hello again, Gallows Creek. This is Forrest Nash. We're circling closer to the truth behind tonight's
events. They wanted a story.
To this end, we're calling back...
Hold on. I have a theory. They wanted a story to make... I have a theory that the Whistling Man never really existed. And because the Whistling Man never existed, they needed a sensational story. Or the Whistling Man was like a real person. They didn't know who it was. They were just content with saying it was George and just sweeping it under the rug and making shit up to make it sound like it was him. Or the Whistling Man existed and it was them and they covered shit up and we're like, okay, let's like take a break because it's a small town and they're going to fucking figure us out soon.
One of our earlier callers, Virginia Sullivan.
It's 3 o'clock in the morning.
Fremant Plunker here. Who's this? Is it you? Goose.
It's not Goose.
Plunker, hey, it's the Radio Man, Forrest Nash.
Radio Man.
Radio Man? What's up?
Solving mysteries, saving lives. The huge.
Right on.
Plunker, I kind of like
what
Plunker.
What are you doing at Virginia's house?
She asked if we could stay to keep an eye out for that whistling turd. So we're hanging out, bro.
Nice.
Well, that's big of you, Plunker.
No, it's nothing.
Can I speak to Virginia?
Sure thing, Radio Man. I'll just go get her.
Who is this?
Hey, Virginia, it's Forrest. I'm glad you're still okay.
Oh, Forrest. Sorry, I'm still jumpy.
I'd be jumpy
can't
too.
Can't blame you. I'd be jumpy too.
I'm so sorry this happened to you, Virginia.
I thought I was. I thought...
Easy. We're not calling to talk about earlier. We're calling because we think you can help us understand why this is happening tonight.
Me? What would I know?
Any guesses?
Well, can you think of any reason why you'd have been targeted?
No, I don't think so.
All right. When you were attacked earlier, you mentioned a name. Clive.
I don't know what I said then. I was petrified, Forrest.
Clive's the janitor at our station. And we know you spoke to him in the past.
Forrest, please. You don't know what you're doing.
I think
He'll
I do.
He'll come for me.
Virginia, it's okay. Clive won't be coming after you.
We think Clive's dead.
Dead? But isn't he? He's the whistling man, Forrest.
We thought so too.
We thought so too, but...
You don't understand. All those years ago, he...
It's okay, Virginia. He's gone. We found evidence to suggest he... Well...
And we found your autopsy reports for George Barrow.
How? I saw him destroy them.
Well, he didn't. I don't know if he kept them or made copies or what, but we found them. And we know it's related to what's happening tonight, which is why we called you. Why did you write a false report?
I... All right. One day, I came into work to find a boy on my slab. And as I finished the autopsy, this man, Clive, he just burst in. And he started making demands.
Nice,
to
nice,
give
nice.
Over the reports, to falsify what I found. Of course I said no, but, well, when someone wants to make you do something, they can use the carrot or the stick.
That's true.
For me, he used both. You see, my sister is sick. She has a chronic condition that's never going away. It's expensive to treat, and it was getting to where I couldn't afford it. And Clive promised me that his employer would pay for my sister's treatment if
okay.
I did what he said. And that if I ever spoke about this, he'd beat me to within an inch of my life. I don't
nice.
Know why he had me do it, but my sister needed me. You have
okay.
to understand. She needed me.
We understand.
I don't.
Thank you, Virginia. That was brave.
God, I just want this nightmare to end.
This will help end it, Virginia. Thank you.
Stay safe, Virginia.
Nice. I wonder what happens if I make 100 of
these. So, Virginia is tied up in all of this.
Clive threatened her to keep quiet about George's death. But for who? Why cover up these details?
I guess we'll never know.
Fuck. If only Sandra had made it. We could have talked to her, too.
Oh, shut up. I know.
I'm sorry we didn't save her.
It's not your fault.
God damn it. It kind of is.
Looks like we've got a call coming
in. I panicked.
Bet. Welcome to 189.16 The Scream with me, your host, Forrest Nash.
Hi, Forrest. I know this is really out of the blue with everything happening tonight. But I wondered if you could send this special birthday message to my uncle.
Sure, why
you
not?
You know what? I'd welcome a change of pace. I'd be glad to.
Thank you, Forrest. He's my Uncle Ronnie. His first name's Peter, but he never liked his name. But since he always had salt and pepper hair, even as a kid, can you believe it? Folks always called him Pepper.
Thanks for the history lesson. Is there anything besides happy birthday you'd like to say to Mr. Pepper? Oh my god, damn it!
Yes! Tell him he can get the best birthday.
Oh my god, I knew it.
You son of a bitch, stop calling us.
Sorry, Forrest. Let's just move on.
God,
we've already got another caller on the line.
That son of a bitch.
This is 189.16, The Scream. I'm Forrest Nash. You're on the air, caller.
Stop caller. Ugly crying. Or is he laughing?
Ponty.
Ponty's Pizza always delivers! Come rain or sleet or whistling man, we'll be there!
I hate everything.
Forrest? Forrest? Are you okay? Forrest?
I hope the whistling man gets him with his own pizza slicer.
Jesus, Forrest.
Sorry, that was too much.
It's okay. It's been a high-stress night. Don't worry about him anymore, okay? Not for tonight, anyway. I think he's spent for now. We've got another call. Whenever you're ready.
I swear to God, if it's Ponty's Pizza, I'll go out killing myself.
Don't spend your money at Ponty's Pizza. That's all I'm going to say about that. Moving along, I'd like to welcome another caller to 189.16 The Scream. With me, Forrest Nash. Who may I say is calling?
Well, hello again, Forrest.
Don? We played your song, Long Ride Home. Did you hear it? Can you tell us?
Never mind that now.
Oh, excuse me?
I'm calling because I need your help.
Are you in danger?
Are you in danger?
Oh, I sure am.
Do you mean...
Yes, he's after me now.
You?
I think so. He must have heard me on the radio helping you.
Right.
Okay. Tell us everything.
I was out following a lead, trying to work out who would be next, after Chuck.
And what happened?
And I started to feel like I was being followed. I came back to my apartment building, but this newfangled security system has me locked out. I need you to help me get inside.
Oh, fuck me.
Don't you have a key to get in?
Only for the apartment door. The front gate requires an
entry
code.
She's the killer, isn't she?
The future is electronic, I guess. I need that code to get inside.
Which apartment block do you live in? Maybe one of our listeners lives there, too.
It's the New Woodside apartment building between a town hall and a trailer park. But I doubt any of your listeners live there. I don't have many neighbors.
Sounds like a prime piece of real estate.
Sound really carries at night. Shit.
A neighbor's dog?
Is that a neighbor's dog?
Yes, it is. Boy, I wish he'd muzzle that thing and... Oh. And now he's blasting David Scopo out of his window. Listen, I can't get any... He's coming down the street. I don't think he's here yet. Forrest, please. I need your help. I need the code for that security system, or I'm gonna die.
Okay.
What's your neighbor's name?
I don't know my neighbors, remember? Please, I need to get in.
What's the name of the security system?
There's a sticker on the box. It says Starling Security 4000. There's a keypad, and it looks like it wants a six-digit number.
Starling Security 4000, huh?
That's right. Very newly installed. I need the key code before the whistling man gets me.
Yeah, of course. Okay. Don't worry, Don.
Thank you, Forrest. I knew I could count on you. I'll sit out of sight. Call me back soon.
Okay.
All right, folks. Here's a little tune for you all to enjoy while I try to break Dawn into her apartment.
Let's go.
Coming up for your listening pleasure, it's Caged Tiger with their single, One Last Goodbye. You were pretty quiet there, Peggy.
Forrest, was it just me, or was there something...
Yeah, it wasn't just you. Something was weird about that.
Yeah, very.
Well, tell you what, we have a Starling 4000 or whatever here at KFAM. Clive bought one for the station. Maybe we can find something to help. Well, I'm not sure who, but to help someone.
Yeah, I think she's the killer. Where is it?
Okay, so she's locked out of the Woodside Apartments, and somewhere, Clive probably has the papers for the Starling 4000.
Okay, where is that? It's the trailer park. Okay, so she's right there. Alright, now I gotta go back to the janitor's office. I don't want to, but I will.
Order delivery form. Starling must have left this by accident.
Ah!
The system's not even installed at Woodside.
Unable to install. Requires new parts. New installation date, the 17th of September. Okay, so it's not even installed there yet, so she's full of shit.
Starling 4000, user manual.
Got it.
Ah, these codes should come in handy.
Alright. So. Please change. Where am I going? What the fuck am I doing with my life? Oh, I'm going this way. Okay, goddamn it. I was trying to read while I was walking and I completely got lost. My ADHD is not that good yet, so we'll try again next time though. When I train up my ADHD powers and start getting all fucking wired and shit like that. Okay, so this we'll put here. This we'll put here. Hold on. So access codes, maintenance call code, alarm test, warning, this will set off all security measures, alarm test deactivation code, and then entry code. Comes with a range of features. Okay. Hey,
welcome
Peggy.
Welcome back, Forrest. Find anything?
The Starling 4000 security manual. It's got a bunch of codes.
Good. And did you find anything else?
I saw a list of everyone else who bought the Starling 4000. Know who was on there?
Oh my god. Roller Ricky! Do you think we should give him a call?
Yes.
Is that crazy?
Yes, we should.
I don't know what you'd say, but...
That might be a good idea.
Okay, one moment. I got the number here. Patching you through.
Put that right there. A little more nice, neat, and tidy.
Shit.
He probably can't hear it over the music. Forrest, I don't know about this. This is super weird.
This
is
super
weird. Put me through to Dawn. I'll take care of this one way or another.
Okay. If you say so. When you're ready, shut the music off. Line one. Whenever you're ready.
Dawn, are you there? This is Forrest Nash from 189.16, The Scream.
Oh, thank God you're back. I'm so afraid. What's the code to the gate?
Give alarm deactivation code. Give maintenance code. Give maintenance
code. The code is 311212.
Thank you, Forrest.
Yeah, that's not ominous. Probably.
I'll just do this the hard way.
Forrest,
What did we do? No!
What? What the fuck?
Betsy! Goddamn!
What the fuck was that?
I'll hunt you down, Maxie!
What the fuck?
Ricky! Hello?
Hello?
What Mark? The shit?
Is that you? Did you have something to do with this?
Ricky, whoever that was, she was trying to get into the building. I tried to help, but...
She? Forrest, man, you got no idea. That was him! That was the whistling man! The alarm gave me just enough time to get my rifle... Maxie, I'm coming, buddy! Forrest, I've gotta go!
Come on, Maxie. Stay
strong. Okay, so Maxie's not dead.
Gallows Creek. Here's some music while we process what just happened.
That was retarded. Maxie's gonna live, though. Maxie gonna live, because Maxie a G. But we got this.
So the whistling man is a woman?
Women can be serial killers too, Peggy.
I had my suspicions.
Yeah, sure, Forrest. You just never mentioned it.
Well, yeah,
she
not on air.
She called up. You spoke to her multiple times.
I thought she was just regular Gallows Creek strange.
That's true.
Really, Forrest? Why do you think she requested that song?
To get me outside?
Maybe, but how? She didn't know the song was outside to start with.
That's right. She never actually attacked me out there.
That's true.
So? What now?
I guess I should make an announcement. We do have new info.
Okay, kill the music and you can make the announcement.
Okay. I don't think you should use the word
kill. You're live in 3, 2...
Hey folks, this is Forrest Nash here. I hope you're all safely locked inside. For those of you listening to that last call, you might be wondering what to make of it all. Here's our take. We now believe the killer is actually a woman, one who might manipulate you into letting her in before she attacks you. We're neighbors. Look out for each other and stay safe. The killer was calling themselves Dawn.
This could be a fake name.
This could be a fake name.
Could
be. If anyone needs help or you have info on the killer, please call in. You folks have my new number, right? It's 911. Hopefully, our next caller can help shed some light on our killer.
I think I'm pretty close to the end of the game.
Hey, we had a call come in.
Okay, folks, time to take a call.
I'm gonna keep going a little bit.
This is Forrest Nash, and you're listening.
Please help me. My name is Casey Moore. I'm at 25 Nancy Drive. My best friend's been stabbed. He's bleeding everywhere. I don't know what to do.
25 Nancy Drive.
Please help me.
What happened?
Somebody's been stabbed. Can you tell me what happened?
We went out at the reservoir. We were heading back to his place when we heard this whistling all of a sudden. He just started freaking out. He screamed at me, told me to hide. I'd never seen him like that. And I just panicked and ran and
so that's
hid in
a
bush.
Bits away.
Oh no. Forrest.
Then what happened?
He went up the road and talked to someone. I couldn't really hear or see anything. It sounded like he might have known the person. And they just stabbed him!
Casey, was he talking to a woman?
I don't know! They had a mask and wore all black? That's all I know! Please, we need help here!
I'll get you help, but I need to know. Where did the masked person go?
They left! They left him to bleed out! I waited until they were gone, then dragged him into the garage and called 911.
Wait. Why didn't she make sure he was dead?
I don't know. I think I heard them say something like, "It's not so funny now, is it?" Before they left, but... Please! He needs to get to the hospital! I can't drive, so we need an ambulance!
Well, we don't have
Forrest,
one.
The ambulance was destroyed in the explosion at the gas station. You should get all the info you can.
Where is he hurt?
Can you tell us where your friend was stabbed?
They stabbed him in the stomach, and then stabbed him again in his leg when he was on the ground, and it's... Oh, the knife is still there in his leg!
Do not take
the knife out. What's your friend's name, Casey?
It's Jason. Jason Parker.
We'll be right back. Peggy, patch us through to the hospital.
On it. Phoning St. Gabriel's now. Switch to line 2.
Oh, now we're doing different lines. Okay.
Hello, St. Gabriel's Hospital. How can I help you?
Hi, this is Forrest Nash from 189.16. We have a stab victim at 25 Nancy Drive named Jason Parker. He's been stabbed in the stomach and the leg. He's bleeding heavily.
Oh, God, I'm sorry. But the ambulance is, well, you know.
Yeah,
I know,
I do.
But please, we need something or he's going to die.
Forrest, listen, you're going to have to get him here. We need to see him, and we can't get there ourselves right now.
We
just have someone get in the car.
We don't drive him right now. And even if we did, he's bleeding out fast.
All right, listen. We need to buy him time to get here.
Tourniquet the leg.
Stopping the blood first, and then finding someone to stabilize him. To stabilize him, you really need someone with first aid training. Do either of you have any?
No.
Me neither.
I do.
Damn it. I'm really sorry about this.
Tourniquet the
leg. But I have
other
patients who can't wait.
And then...
All
staunch
I can do
it with
the
gauze
can,
in the stomach wound.
The rest to you. You think you can handle that?
We don't have much of a choice.
We don't really have much choice. Hit me.
Okay, from the top.
From the top.
He's bleeding out. Then you need to get him comfortable and try to stem the bleeding.
Uh-huh.
Lay him down. Apply continuous pressure directly to the affected areas. When the bleeding slows, get a clean cloth of some kind and hold it over the wounds.
Get them comfortable. Apply pressure.
Clean
cloths when slowed.
Yes.
Got it, I think.
You said he was stabbed, right? If the object he was stabbed with is still in him,
leave it in there.
Take it out.
Leave it in there.
It's stopping the
Always.
Worst of the bleeding right now. If anything,
that
you should
is.
Secure it so it stays where it is.
I wouldn't have thought of that.
I would have.
It makes sense, though. God, that was a lot of info. But I think we can handle this.
Glad you got it so far, because there's more to go.
Fuck me. You sure you can't
this
stay?
This is a lot to remember. Are you sure you can't stay on the line?
We're wasting time. Please, just let me continue.
Okay, whatever,
if
bitch.
If he's lost a lot of blood, he may enter shock. If he does, act fast. If you apply a cloth and it's bleeding through, don't remove it. Just apply another on top of it.
Another on
if
top.
If it's safe, elevate his legs to get blood circulating to his vital organs.
100%.
Try to keep him warm. Get him to rest and reassure him. We need the patient to stay calm.
Yep.
All right. Don't replace bandages. Elevate his legs.
Yep.
Keep him warm and calm.
Yep.
This is a lot.
I'm really sorry. That's as much as I can give you right now. Try to stop the bleeding. Find someone to get him stabilized and get him here as quick as you can. Good luck.
Okay.
All right, Forrest. Casey's still on line 1.
Bet. Let's do it.
Hello? Hello? Forrest, are you there?
All right. How is Jason?
I'm here. How is Jason doing?
Badly. He's still bleeding. I need help. I've been putting pressure on his stomach wound since you left. But he's still bleeding. I don't know what to do.
That's good, Casey. The nurse said to do that.
What
Step
about
one.
The knife in his leg? It's gotta be hell. Should I pull it out?
No. Don't touch the knife.
No, don't touch the knife. The bleeding will get worse if you pull it out.
Are you sure? I'm sorry. I'm gonna stop making suggestions.
That's a good
no,
step.
No, don't worry, Casey. We're a team here. We're all going to get Jason through this. Casey, is his leg wound bleeding right now?
I hate looking at that knife. Yeah. It's bleeding. His stomach is worse, though.
I think we need to secure the knife so it doesn't move around. Do you have anything you can tie around it?
Yeah. There's some laundry piled up on top
oh,
of the dryer.
Oh, bet. That's the
Clothes
best.
On the hood of the car, and what else? I guess I've got my jacket.
Use the laundry.
Look in the laundry for something like a towel or a shirt.
Any of it. Any of it.
Hold that over the wound.
Okay. Looks like I'm gonna have to buy you some new whites, Jason. Here we go. I'm sorry, Jason. It's secure.
Casey, I'm going to have a quick word with Peggy. Keep putting that pressure on and let us know when the bleeding is under control. You're doing great.
But what if something happens?
We'll still be here. Just shout if you need anything and we'll be there.
Yep.
I promise.
Got it.
Okay. I'll wait. Jason, please be okay.
What's up, Peggy?
We can't stay on the line with her all night. Dawn is still out there. What if other people need us?
You're right. She's probably on her way to her next target right now.
Exactly. And you heard the nurse. We need someone there with training who can stabilize him. He's got to get to the hospital somehow.
Any suggestions, Peggy?
I might. A little before you started working here, KFAM did a mandatory first aid training course.
Okay.
Me and Karen missed it because we were away on a producer getaway.
You skipped it, didn't you? Never mind. So, how does KFAM's first aid course help us?
Casey said they're at 25 Nancy Drive, right?
Yeah. Why?
They put up a bunch of cheap houses around there about 10 years ago. So a bunch of people here at the station live around there.
Do you think any of them could help Casey and Jason?
Probably, but I don't know who lives there. And since I missed the training day, I don't know who knows first aid.
Could you call them and ask?
I don't know everybody's numbers.
Oh my god.
I've only ever called Karen. Everybody's personnel info is probably in Reggie's office.
Got it. I'll look through their files in Reggie's office. It's a life or death situation. I'm sure they won't mind.
Right. But there are a couple of
problems.
Oh
my god. Like what? Naturally.
Naturally.
It's sensitive information, so Reggie probably locked it in his safe.
Great. Great. Do you have any idea what the combo for the safe could be?
Not a clue. Reggie's a serial note taker, though. Maybe something in his office will give it away. Right. There is something else.
I'm not gonna like this, am I?
Have you ever heard, the future is floppy?
Peggy, what the hell are you talking about?
Floppy disks.
I'm talking
oh
about floppy disks. Floppy disks are like these futuristic things that have information on them.
Oh, that's
you put them
funny.
In a computer and they do something.
Peggy, I know what a floppy disk is.
Yeah.
Anyway, Reggie decided that the future is floppy and started phasing out our physical records and replacing them with these floppy disks. I imagine
I like the way
it's
she
the
said
same for
disks.
Our personnel files.
That's good to know. Since we haven't heard anything from Casey, I'm guessing Jason's okay for now. I'll check out Reggie's office and see what I can find.
You'll need a key for that. I'll just slide it under my
Why
door.
Do you have all the Thanks, keys Peggy. To this shit, bitch?
I just have to look around.
Okay, before I do that... Oh, I made it to 123. Fuck yeah. Before I do that, I'm going to end the episode here. We've been going for a hot minute, so I was hoping that I was close to the end. I'll find out, like, I'll do just enough research to find out how much longer I've got in the game, and then we'll go from there. Until then, like, comment, subscribe, tell me what you want to see more of, tell me what you want to see less of, tell me what you love, tell me what you hate, all that good stuff in the comment section below, and I'll catch y'all in the next episode.